So good morning, everyone. I'm the business guy. And well, it always doesn't mean that I have the money, but sometimes. Few words about my background. So I'm a construction engineer as an education and have been working in the construction business, let's say 25 years. Some of you may not have been born when I started. Nevertheless, bit over a year ago, I was running the IT department in YIT and dealing that 4 years. And what we started on that time was building the basics right. We saw that we have to get the services on the cloud, data on the cloud, build on the analytics, and we started investing on that. Quite many millions. And that was the start. Okay, thank you. Nope. Yes, now it works. Thanks. All right. That's why I chose the construction. Yep. Let's go backwards first. All right. Here. So you all know that there are some challenges in the construction business. Productivity has been staying on the level of 70s and not much improving. And we can ask that what is the reason for that? So there are a few reasons, and we could discuss about that for a few hours. But first of all, basically the projects are pilot projects every time. Secondly, we have teams changing, people changing, new people coming to the business, and we don't have the basic setup when we are doing the construction. Third issue is that we are doing the works outside in the natural conditions, in raining, in snowing, just mention it. All these together ensure the situation that we have high difficulties on learning what we are doing. So imagine a construction project being an ice hockey team, what it would mean in practice. For each game, we get new players which have different targets, and the whole team does not have same targets at all. So would we win the gold medal with that kind of team? Hell no. One big issue what we are missing is data. So what we are actually doing, what is the result? And that we are trying to cover now in YIT. Few words about the company. Turnover close to 4 billion, 10,000 people working in different locations, blue collars, white collars, and so on. What is quite interesting is this net promoter score, which is 52 at the moment. Target is it to be 54. And when we compare this to different kinds of businesses, banking business, all other businesses, so this is quite high. And still, we can read from the magazines that people are not so satisfied with the construction business. There is small gap there in the understanding. One reason why this is so high is that when you buy an apartment, we are heading to very good service and zero defect from the quality side. And we are quite successful on that. Yep. Few words about the operations. So here you can see the countries where we are operating. Housing is focused in Finland, CE countries and Russia. Then we have business premises mainly in Finland, Baltic countries, and Poland, Czech and Slovakia. And also investing on the business premises in the same countries. Infra side is Scandinavia, Baltics. And then the segment where I come from is the paving. And paving includes mineral aggregates. So paving is operating in Norway, Sweden, Finland, Denmark, Russia, and in some extent in Baltic countries as well. And now when we dive deeper in the mineral aggregates where my business case is coming from, so we are operating in Finland, Norway, and Sweden. In Finland, we have over 200 quarries at the moment in operative use. So places where we get the rock and stones. In Norway, we have quite many as well. But what is the difference in Norway is that we have very huge pits there. So the places where we can get the stones 50 or 100 years from now on. And a few bits in Sweden. But let's go a bit deeper that what is really the problem. So when we are comparing our mineral aggregates business to best competitors in the world, we set it a target that we have to double the EBIT, the profitability of the business. And we believe that that can be done. So we were first investigating that what might be the reasons behind, so what creates the gap in the profitability. First of all of us, including the competitors, use the same kind of machines. So we get wheel loaders, we get excavators, crushing plants from the same manufacturers. So those are global companies producing the machines. So that cannot be the difference. Then we have huge amount of quarries. It cannot be so that we have the worst ones that nobody else has. And we have good locations with the good stones, quality stones and so on. So that's not the case. Then the market is same to all. Pricing is very open and we are competing against each other. So we have basically only one big solution or answer left what makes the difference in profitability. It is the process, how we run the process. Then here you can see in the middle one typical crushing plant. As you can see, poorly in natural conditions, noise, vibration, dust, as heavy conditions as it can be. How the process goes? So, firstly, let's see if it comes from, yep. We have to feed in the raw material, the stones from here. Then it goes to the first crusher, on the conveyor belt to the second crusher, and then we have a conveyor belt again, and sieves, and then finally we have the output. So different kind of crushed stones. Sounds very simple. At the pit we have team working with three persons. So typically one is feeding in the stones, driving excavator. One is getting the ready-made crushed stones with the wheel loader, working on the other end of the process. And then one guy is doing the maintenance work or changing the places with others so that keep the plant running all the time. So quite simple, not too complex. And the profitability of this kind of plant is really based at what is the maximum output of the plant. If you roughly estimate the profitability of one plant, so one plant has to make profit few thousand euros per day to make the 1 year profit on a good level. Doesn't sound much, I agree, but keeping in mind that this one year around, over 200 days in a year, and the selling price for the aggregates is roughly 1 euro per ton. That's not much. And keeping in mind this profitability level, one mistake can ruin your profit for the day. So, what we have to do to make everything correct? So first of all, stone feeding is very important. If you feed too much, it gets jammed and you can get nothing out. And then somebody has to open the jaw of the crusher. Secondly, we have the main crusher there in the middle. Let's say it's a cone type of crusher. If you are running it on too high speed, it means that the stones don't have time to drop down in the crusher, and then you get really fine coarse aggregate, and the output is not so high. If you run it too slow, then you get jams, and again, you have to stop the whole plant. Then the feeders, you have to be very exact on the angles, on the speed. If you run too high speed, then the stones start jumping and going out from the feeder. And with the sieves, the angle is very important. So if you have a wrong angle, you don't get good enough the fine courses out from the material. And maybe the biggest one is the maintenance. So the location is always somewhere in the middle of the nowhere, where you don't get the maintenance. If something gets broken, you don't get the maintenance, let's say, in one day. It might take 2 days. So the three men working there on the place, they have to be able to fix basically everything. And also one very important issue is that the location of the plant. So you typically locate the plant so that it can stand 1 or 2 days in one place, and then you move it. But if you have done it wrongly, then you have to move it maybe twice or three times a day, and it ruins your profitability. So why we have problems here? As said, we have three men working on the plant. It might be so that they are not so experienced, they don't know how to make the settings, how to run the plant. They have not had enough training, or they are just lazy. Let's do it the same way as we did yesterday. I was participating in the springtime in US in one training, that how to really run this kind of plant. And there was a good answer. It's science and it's magic. So magic comes from the part that you have to test at the site that are your settings correct. And then if they are correct, then just go on and do the profit. So now you know the problem what we have. So how we started solving this is that first of all, in crushing plant, we have a lot of electronics. So it's run by electronic engines. There are hydraulic pumps, and it uses electric power. So kind of small computer inside. So we have already a lot of information there flowing in the plant. The problem was how to get the data out from the plant itself. So we had a different experiments and ended up using this kind of Dell's Edge box, which actually expands the Azure to the plant. So we upload the data directly on top of Azure. What data we get at the moment is hydraulic pressure, temperature of the hydraulic liquid, how much power the whole plant uses, and also if we have error messages coming from the device. So that kind of issues we get at the moment. And the delay is now about 1 minute. It could be shorter, but we have said that we have investigated that there is no sense to have a shorter delay. And data has been modeled so that we can compare the data coming from the different sources, different plants. We have 4 plants at the moment connected via IoT, and this all has been done during the 6 months. And here on the right-hand side, you can see a few graphics what we have. So we can get the data minute by minute and so on. And what this data tells to you, it actually raises questions. So for example, why we have some stops here? What is happening here? Why we have peaks? Here's probably a jam in the plant. And when we start collecting this data and comparing with the different plants, then we learn to see that what is the most optimal way to run the plant. Before this, we were collecting so-called diary of the crushing plant, where the guys were recording all the breaks over 15 minutes. But then again, you can imagine all of us are human beings, and you record what you remember or what you want to record. With this, we can really openly see what is happening. Now we are providing this as a dashboard to our site managers so that they can monitor what is happening at the site. But this is just a start. It's easy to call to those three guys that, hey, you have now something wrong, you should do some maintenance. What we have experienced so far, for example, in one crushing site, we had 4 crushers in a line. And when we got all the data out of those crushers, we saw that the last crusher was basically standing idle all the time. So why to waste money there? Price of this one crusher is close to €1 million. So in the very beginning we are here. What's going to happen next is that we have to expand this solution to cover all the fleet what we have. So we have roughly 20 crushers in Finland, about 10 in Norway, and get more data. Then we would like to combine here external data as well. So data what we get from the wheel loaders, excavators, maybe some weather data as temperature and so on, and go much, much deeper in the analytics. We have good experiences with other businesses utilizing machine learning, for example, in road maintenance. And this is something what we would like to do, try a different kind of correlations with different issues. So develop the best possible process in crushing the stones and being number one in the world after a few years. Also, what we have learned and what we've seen is that this could be easily expanded to different kind of businesses. So let's take, for example, asphalt plant, which is run by computer. Although the technology is quite old, computer is running all the feeders, heating ovens, mixers, silos, everything. So we have a lot of data available there. We have about 40 asphalt plants in Finland. And if you could get the data out of those, we could improve the efficiency of those a lot. One big issue there is the temperature as well. So at the moment, we are running on too high temperature, quite big amount of asphalt plants, which also means utilizing wrongly the fuel, increasing the CO2 emissions and so on. So there is one opportunity what we could do as well. Then one issue what we investigated last year was the paving team itself. We had a 360 camera on top of one paver for one day, 9 hours, looking what's happening there. And guess what was the efficient production time for one day? It was only 20% of the working time. All the other time there was happening something else. If we could double that or increase 50%, it would mean that we need less teams or we can do more with the cheaper. So really believe that in this kind of business where we are at the moment in this technology, we could really increase the profitability by utilizing IoT and analytics and machine learning. Last words ending my presentation. It's quite funny that we are nowadays talking about analytics and machine learning. Already in 1995, we were forerunners. I'm not talking about Finland in large scale. In Finland, developing neural network calculations. Somebody of you might remember Professor Kohonen, who was developing that neural network calculations. And on that time, it was on top of the world. And now the machine learning has been coming back. But basically, we are dealing with the same issues. How to do the issues, what human brains could do or could not do more efficiently and with more profit. So we are on a good way and really seeing that we will get the best out of this experiment and expand it. That shortly. Any questions, any comments?